Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We had, of course, my intro there with Jack Outer World and the Quantum Singularity with Corporate Cosmology, followed by, oh, I can't even remember now, oh, it's Redding and I Can't Turn You Loose. And then finally, the track that I really needed was a bit of Fun Loving Criminals and Smoke 'em If You Got 'em. Been a bit of a lackluster week, to be quite honest. It's just one of those kind of midwinter go nowhere weeks where everything's kind of everything I touch turns to crap. These things happen occasionally. But before I get into all that depressing malarkey, I'd just like to first of all give out a big PIR welcome to all of our international listeners. I noticed we've got Kieran in the chat again tonight. Well, that's PIR going out to Costa Rica. Got quite a few of Kieran's been publicising my work around his local area and been noticing lots of Costa Rica hits on my YouTube channel, which is always really nice to see. I don't know if any of you are aware of the sort of analytical dissection that you can do of YouTube uploads as an uploader. But essentially, there's a section on YouTube as an uploader that you can go and look and see basically all of the activity of pretty much, I mean, all of the known data on your specific video uploads. And while I was delving around in there last week, obviously, apart from seeing our Kieran and his Nicaraguan posse, his Costa Rican posse in the house, I was really quite surprised. I was taken aback because the on the Omniversity channel, you know, I mean, 1,000 hits in total, a handful of subscribers. I picked up 50 subscribers. I mean, that don't mean that I'm knocking it in any way. I mean, the last month for the Omniversity, I've been pushing the Omniversity on every forum that I possibly can for the last getting on for a year now. It may even be just over a year now with the Omniversity. The last month, I've doubled the number of hits that I'd got in the preceding year, and doubled the number of users, subscribers, that I had in the preceding year. So that's moving on very nicely. And I'll go on later to explain precisely why the Omniversity. I mean, most people just probably think that I'm that weird sciencey guy that has all stupid ideas and can't help talking about them. But it is a bit more than that. There's a bit more underlying that. So I'm going to explore that tonight with energy independence. But yeah, just the international listeners, it just I was gobsmacked to see in my YouTube analytics on Omniversity, you know, the typical, I mean, top one was UK, second one was USA, third one I think was Ireland, which is all pretty standard fare, considering we're in a sort of radio station based somewhat in Ireland and the UK. With American hosts, so none of those three are particularly surprising. Number four, Guernsey. Yep, I want to put a big shout out to the Guernsey posse that are in the house. Okay, I don't know if they're joining us in the chat, whether they're listening to us live, or whether they're just finding my stuff on YouTube, which is entirely possible. If that is the case, Guernsey posse, come on over, join the chat. Yeah, if you accept that everybody's sovereign, that's your only parameter. That's your only limitation to joining us on PIR, both as a chat box Denzian, listener, a potential collaborator. Yeah, PIR is like the radio in your living room, the living room radio in your living room. I mean, Paul decided not to come over tonight, but no, Paul's in the chat. Well, he'll be over tomorrow night. And this is the beauty of PIR is that we're not on some kind of pedestal, or hard to find, or particularly private about our affairs. And this is, I mean, if you listen to us, if you appreciate what we say, then, I mean, come join us in our research groups, come and join us in person, come to our meetups, come find out where we're all at. Another shout out that's got to go out is the Trinidad and Tobago posse. My listener in Trinidad and Tobago. I don't know how on earth this person found me or why they've stuck with me all these years, but I always, on every single one of my videos, I have one hit from Trinidad and Tobago. Every single one. And when we used to, back in the old TNS days, when we used to have the TNS Globe, about 15 minutes before my show, the TNS Globe used to show one hit in the Caribbean, and it would light up Trinidad and Tobago, and I'd see it going round and round, and I always used to remember to give them a shout back in the day. They've never made themselves known to me. You know what I mean? Come on, guys. You know, unless you're some sort of government agent or something, and on assignment in Trinidad and Tobago for the last 7 years or something. You know what I mean? poke your head in the chat and say hi. Curacao as well. I had to go and look up where Curacao was. That's another Caribbean island, but even smaller than Trinidad and Tobago. And I seem to have picked up quite a few hits from Curacao. So for some reason, my voice appears to be being picked up in the strangest of places. Latvia's another one because of Ojar and all his mates out there. He keeps going home and visiting his folks and seeing all his mates out there and introducing all these English spoken ones to this mad Londoner that he's always hanging out with. Oh yeah, I'm going to play this. You guys are probably all going to hate this, but I don't care. I mean, seriously, this is just like so good that if you don't get it, well, you just like get new ears or something. Two heroes of mine, both. Oh, get a life. Seriously, Microsoft, you make that horrible noise to tell me to try Office? Bend over, Bill Gates, I've got a message for you. Two of my greatest hero, musical heroes, Captain Beefheart, who, much like yourselves, you probably don't like that much. Well, same here. Very difficult man to listen to, but a talent unlike anything else that I know. When he got it right, man, it was right. And he had this way of never listening to anybody else's music. So he remained entirely uninfluenced by anybody else's crap throughout his entire recording career, which is, again, a significant thing. Many people don't know the number of stars that arrived on our scene through him. Ry Cooda was actually in the first Magic band. Ry Cooda, the most famous world famous guitarist that you've never heard of. And this is Frank Zappa again. Frank Zappa, world renowned, I would say, I would say most likely the world's finest guitarist, certainly the most accomplished guitarist. And this is the only song that I've ever heard him strum on, which leads me to the suspicion that he was equally as enamoured of what Beefheart is doing here, both lyrically and vocally. And with all of my music, this isn't just pop pap that you're going to find on bloody Radio 1 or, you know, in any of the commercial stations, because they won't play this stuff. I mean, 99% of the songs that I play you will never hear on commercial radio. Okay, and the reason for that is that most of them have a message. Now, Beefheart's message is a little more tortuous to untangle than most musicians. But essentially, what Beefheart is doing here is he has completely dismantled the concept of song. And what you have is this beautiful prose. And the prose is placed within a musical landscape. And the combination of the prose and the musical landscape, for me, just I feel myself sitting in some, like, American prairie desert while I'm listening to this. It just completely transports me. Anyway, here's Beefheart and Zappa with Orange Claw Hammer.
Why don't you want to do a version of Orange Claw Hammer live in the studio?
Yeah. I could actually play that again. I know that you lot would all just leave in droves if I did, but damn it, I might just do it. spite you. Yeah, one of the extraordinary talents of Frank Zappa and Captain Beefheart. So onto the subject of tonight's show. Directly at the bottom of the page, I could have sworn I actually put something in that blog post, but maybe I just thought that the graph said it all. But if you go down to the blog post bit down at the bottom of the page, you'll see a blog for tonight's show there. I think its title's Energy Independence. And if you click on that, it'll open in a new tab. And as it opens in a new tab, you should see the sort of the graph that's currently shown small on the screen should be much larger on the screen and easily visible. It's not my intention to scare anybody, but a few of us here, including myself and Vin, have come through the sort of the various sort of political philosophies. And having grown through a degree of anarchic, sort of crush the state, smash the state, it's too corrupt, we're now broadly of the opinion that the state is an incredible, fragile object, and it's incredibly precious, and it's taken hundreds, if not thousands, of years to craft. And essentially, although it appears to be not fit for purpose, without it, we would be lost. Currently, we have nothing to replace it with. So unless you have a full model that will cater for everybody's needs as well as the current system, then do not call for its demise unduly. Okay, that's essentially where we're going here. Now, the reason why I say this... there have been, just to put it into context, I became aware, very aware, of the impending sort of crises facing humanity a long, long time ago, certainly back in the 80s, and my course of action from that knowledge was effectively to join the convoy, to move on the road, and to reject everything that I saw as profane about the culture that I saw creating the misery and the mess that that I was seeing all around me and appeared to be getting worse. Let's wait for these two Herberts to leave. Ah, oh, for God's sakes, I might just have to put on another tune for a second because they're going to take ages and this door's wide open. Try not to make too much noise, you gits. I joined the convoy. What you lot might know as the New Age Travellers, I don't know, Pikeys. whatever you want to call us, I don't care. I didn't really become one of the convoy. I've always maintained a staunch independence from any group that I've been party to, sometimes to my own detriment, but that always leaves me as kind of the outsider. But I moved on the road and lived with the convoy, should we say, as one of them, as one of their fellows, for between 8 and 10 years. The time span just really kind of drifts. It's really hard for me to work out exactly how long I was actually on the road for, because when I remember all of the seasons that I spent and knowing where I spent them, I can stack up at least 10 years, and yet when I checked the calendar when I moved back off the road, it was only 8 years appeared to have passed. So I really have absolutely no idea exactly how long I was on the road for and how much of it I simply imagined. Or something along those lines. All time's a bit more plastic than you think it is. I certainly spent a lot of that time living without clocks or calendars. But essentially, the life on the road, it was a bit of a Mad Max-esque existence. I mean, we were the sort of road warriors. I mean, we were using very little of what we saw as sparse resources to do as much as we possibly could. And to a greater or lesser degree, achieving quite a significant, I should imagine, the travelling community as a group, the net saving in energy that we must have made through the decades that we were a successful movement gathering in numbers, must have been not insignificant. The savings in water costs, in the fact that none of us bothered to wash, that's quite a significant saving, and that in and of itself is quite a peculiar thing to try and get across to people that have never ever had to sort of go out and acquire their living water. We all kind of have become entirely acclimatized to water that just comes out of the tap, clean, fresh, ready to use. But of course, if your nearest tap is 7 miles away, your life becomes a very different affair. And obviously you can collect rainwater and things like this, but rainwater is not the best of things for drinking, really. Funnily enough, it's got too low a mineral content. Rainwater is pretty much distilled water, and it's not the best of stuff to drink over a long term. Not enough minerals in it for what we used to. Anyway, so yeah, we essentially lived, I learned to live by the wood stove, the outside fire for cooking on. I eventually acquired, shall we say, some solar panels and a small wind turbine, and as a result was able to live a kind of pseudo-modern lifestyle, really. I had a very small television set, a 4-inch screen or a 6-inch screen or something, but I had a colour TV. It didn't get watched very often. I used to live in a cupboard. I had a hi-fi, a radio, and kept in communication with the outside world. Some of my colleagues at the time were beginning to get mobile phones and things like this. Admittedly, huge, great big brick things that had to stay in their rig, but... So we were a kind of a literal expression of neo-feudalism, possibly even a direct consequence of the sort of new age neo-feudalism that I think was part of a sort of Tavistock agenda, really being driven right back from the sort of 60s and 70s. Anyway, during this time, I began to learn just what a precious resource things like a gallon of fuel actually consisted of. I mean, some of the summer sites, especially where water was at an absolute premium, you would literally spend half of every day going to collect water and bringing it back for you to use. I mean, for the rest of that day and maybe the following day. Or you would use some sort of motorised vehicle. Well, that's all well and good, providing that you have the fuel to put in that motorised vehicle, and suddenly, a trickle of fuel becomes a very critical thing. An entire group of people are now not necessarily reliant, because we learnt not to be reliant on anything technological to any great degree. Self-reliant. Interdependence is another thing as well. I think the society of today has lost its sensation of being interdependent. And I suppose that's kind of really where we need to sort of place this into context, is that many of the things that we take for granted, the shops full of food, the water, the taps full of water, the ceaseless petrol at the pumps, the ability to move freely about the country, even about the world, without any significant cost, is largely being borne out by the impending crisis facing humanity as the fossil fuels begin to run out, being entirely masked. I suspect even that the energy companies may be in a degree of denial about this, that the drive for profits won't allow any corporate decisions that will prevent the cliff being reached at its current pace. And the cliff that's coming with the end of sufficient fossil fuel reserves, and you could consider the speed at which we approach the cliff a bit like jumping off a cliff with a car. I mean, if you hit the cliff slow enough, you might rumble down the other side. But if you go off it doing 100 miles an hour, you're going to crash and burn. And this is essentially, I was following a very wise old, I think he was a Stanford economist, actually, but not really in the public domain. And I wish that I could find the audio now. And it was a really old recording of him. I stumbled across him in 2005, and essentially his work was a mathematical derivation of the consequences, the economic consequences of a fossil fuel economy, and the economic consequences of the end of fossil fuel sufficiency. Now, by fossil fuel, I'm not talking peak oil here particularly, although I sincerely believe that we are rapidly approaching that particular milestone in human history. What I'm talking about here is the ability to use the fossil fuels that we have as if they are a never-ending abundance, which is essentially how we use them to this day. And just to put this into context, I would suggest that it would be a wise experiment for most people to try to empty all of the fuel out of their tank and to refill their tank with nothing more than a litre of petrol. And you'd actually need a bit more than that in your tank anyway, because otherwise the tank would just be dry anyway, because a litre spread across your petrol tanks is nothing. But to take an empty fuel tank, a tank that has been run empty, put precisely 1 litre of petrol in it, and drive as far as you can on that litre. Now, most vehicles these days are in excess of 25 miles to the gallon as an average consumption. Well, a gallon is 5 litres, so that gives you 5 miles that you're going to drive on that litre, which has cost you £1. Now see how much it costs you to pay a bunch of local teenagers to push you that 5 miles home. And there, what you've actually got there is a direct proportional representation of what that litre of fuel was actually worth in man hours. Okay, so this is kind of the way that we need to start looking at this, is unless you're prepared to do it yourself, then fossil fuels are an incredibly powerful, compact source. It's energy density is what we're talking about here. I might chuck a tune on, actually, and just bring up a couple of Google charts, because there's a couple of stats that would be handy to know here, because a lot of people are probably screaming at their radios right now, but renewables, sustainable, third report to the UN, the one that you lot didn't get to hear, pretty much put paid to any suggestions that there may be an easy out through renewables. There may have been one 25 years ago, but guys, we blew the bank. We took the fossil fuel reserves that we had to be able to build the 21st century, and we wasted them on cheap shit from China. And I mean, unless you're planning on converting all of those wonderful little plastic doodabs back into the oil reserves that they came from, which can be done, you can reconvert plastic back into burnable combustible liquid fuels, but you're gonna use an awful lot of energy doing it. In fact, it's one of the things that kind of puts a wry smile on my face, that the 21st century's mining and drilling is likely to be the mining and drilling of the 20th century's bloody rubbish dumps, because if we've done anything through the 20th century, it was to take all of those fossil fuel reserves, turn them into plastics that don't degrade for 20,000 years, and then bulldoze that plastic into a hole in the ground. So I can see a very near future event where all of those plastics are going to be one of the most demanded resources left on the planet. So Okay, well, as usual, I should have done a bit of prep here. Stats are not all that easy to find in an easily disseminatable format on any of this stuff, but what I've been able to pull up just on a 2012 figure, UK's electricity only usage. That's not the petrol that you put in your tank, that's not all the trucks that you've seen flying up and down the roads, that's not the delivery trucks that delivered all your goods, or the stuff that delivered that to the store, or the boats that brought it to the country, or the gas that you used to cook it on, or the gas that you used to heat your house with, or the gas that they used to fire the aluminium smelting ovens that made all your tin cans and all that. So essentially this is just the electricity. 300 million megawatts a year. Now, to put that into context, a megawatt is 1,000 kilowatts. So, I mean, you can add an extra three noughts after that if you want to reduce it down into numbers of bar fires for an hour. Which is just a phenomenal amount of energy. And when you look at where, I mean, if you, again, I direct you to that graph, if you go looking at that graph and see exactly on the American scale there where nuclear and renewables are on that scale, and essentially I think apart from France, there isn't a major Western democratic country that produces more than 5% of its energy using nuclear. As if you even believe that nuclear is real, which I might cover on a later show. I'm still going into the nuclear argument. I'm not swayed particularly one way or the other, but certainly some very interesting arguments being presented by the no nuke, not no two nukes, but the no nuclear doesn't exist brigade. But anyway, disregarding nuclear power, because it's effectively too small a proportion of any country's domestic supply to be of any great significance. Essentially, all of that energy is being produced either by hydro or by fossil fuels, and there's very few countries in the world that actually produce a majority of their energy from hydro or any sort of renewables. Iceland is one of the few that's getting pretty close, and I suspect that's possibly why they were able to do their banking independence thing, because they weren't able to be held to ransom by the fossil fuel companies and their banking cartels. But that's a supposition, that's not anything that I can say for certain. So yeah, essentially we have a pitifully small conversion to renewables, to solar and to wind. And America's got particular problems with local small-scale generation, because their entire national grid was built to the sort of competition, the capitalist competition model, and so the American grid isn't actually a single grid; it's about five or six different sort of semi-monopolies have built large sections of the grid. And then when they effectively meet at a point, they have to somehow get their systems to play nicely. And some of the consequences of the stories surrounding the initial trying to get the American grid systems to play nicely together involve some fairly hairy-assed transformer explosions and power station fires and stuff when shit went a bit pear-shaped. I know we're not supposed to be clicking lighters on here, sodger. All right, so Freeman Jack, so if it's going to be adult language, yeah, shut up. you have been warned. I'll try my best not to. Where was I? What's my thread now? Completely lost my thread. This is where show notes helps. Sometimes. essentially. So we have this enormous energy demand and 99% of it is being drawn from fossil fuels currently. That demand, while having leveled off largely in the West, is exponentially growing in the Far East. All of those cheap goods that you're buying from China currently, all of your cheap electronics, your iPhones and all these sort of things, and just things that you wouldn't imagine that come from there. I mean, things that you thought were English brands or European brands will just be relabeled in the country of origin from Chinese manufacturer. And basically all of this is being made on the back of the existing Chinese coal reserves and the fact that China is just hoovering up fossil fuel reserves all around the planet at the minute to feed this kind of monster of their growing sort of corporate identity. I mean, nobody can really knock them for it, you know what I mean? They've been under the gun for long enough, you know what I mean? It's about time they had an industrial revolution 300 years behind. Now, I think that while a lot of this is looking fairly intransient, I think that to some degree we have run our course. And if that analysis is a prudent analysis of the coming events, as essentially with there's a lot of different ways that you can look at the subject of peak oil or peak fossil fuel. There are a lot of arguments suggesting that oil is virtually like a glandular exudation of the planet and is a self-refreshing natural resource that will constantly keep refilling the fields. Certainly a lot of the Texan oil fields that had been pumped dry and then have been just closed down have recently been rediscovered to have refilled to about two-thirds of their previous volume. And certainly, you know, I mean, when peak fossil fuel does hit, Texas will probably accede from the rest of the states, because it's about the only state that is actually energy independent. Energy independence, that was the subject of the show, I remember. So we have these kind of localized islands of energy independence, which are effectively going to go on to become local superpowers. If you have the wherewithal to fuel an army, then you have the wherewithal to at least protect your borders beyond that of a neighbouring state which doesn't have fuel independence. Wars are going to be fought over this. I would suggest that the two major wars in Iraq were actually more about securing major oil fields and securing international supply from domestic supply. The Iraqis were looking very much like they were about to do a Saudi and were about to launch themselves onto the world stage in a big way. And really one of the biggest problems facing us currently is Saudi domestic consumption, because effectively when Saudi domestic consumption, which has been on an exponential curve since the 1970s, since 1974, when the West started plying oil dollars into the sort of minor Arab sheikhs to turn them into the sort of financial titans that they are today, that their domestic production and their domestic consumption are on rapidly approaching collision courses. And I would suggest that the Saudi elites would probably go a long way to protect their current status within both their own countries, the local Middle Eastern political environment and the global political environment. And I would suggest that when that production and consumption curve meet, we're essentially going to see Middle Eastern oil dry up. Could well see sort of takeover wars and stuff like that to overthrow local, but you know what I mean, the local population are now empowered, educated. They're not the sand niggers, the sort of corporate interests found all those years ago in the desert. So essentially we have a global marketplace where oil is the biggest mover and shaker. Was it gold oil and drugs? That's the god we trust. In God we trust. And I can't really see any way out of it. The reports are not looking good. The time for wide scale conversion to renewables was probably 25 years ago, and to be quite honest, a lot of the technologies weren't really mature enough to be able to handle wide scale conversion at the time. Oh yeah, I was talking about the American grid. Yeah, the problems with the American grid are that micro generators going in on that grid put fluctuations that the grid stability just simply isn't in place to be able to cater for. And there's some suggestion that America simply cannot convert over to local renewables without actually collapsing the grid completely and going over to much smaller scale sort of local domestic grids. I mean, like a town grid, that small. America's also in big trouble. Their bridges, you won't hear this being publicised, but a survey was done of all of their major road bridges, and their major road bridges are in a terrible state, and frankly there isn't enough steel in the country to remake them all, or enough money left in the coffers after all of the international wars to pay for them to be made. So there's another sort of crisis looming on the horizon in the next sort of 20 years for America, is that their major transport links are going to start to fail. In addition to this, the leaky old American grid with its suspect corporate construction is hugely subject to something called coronal mass ejections. There was a major shutdown of a large part of the North American grid. It was the entirety of New York State, and it went right up into sort of Canada, shut down a load of the Canadian grid. And that was when a coronal mass ejection basically knocked out a load of the transformer stations on the line, just put a big spike of power onto the entire grid and just blew loads of transformers and stuff. And some areas were out of power for weeks on end. And frankly, that coronal mass ejection was, okay, it was an unlucky hit, but it was like a once in 100 years event. Well, as we saw with that Cumbria storm, there are also once in 1,000 year events that of an entirely different magnitude order than the sort of ripple flows that we see coming out ordinarily. And certainly a once in 1,000 year coronal mass ejection to hit the States would do such catastrophic damage to all of the hardware that their entire electrical grid and oil grid, for that matter, is, because they're both interdependent, because all of the pumps for the oil and gas are of course electric, that the ceramics are actually the key weak point, again, because of the American total sort of devotion to the capitalist model, that the ceramic insulators that hold the wires apart are only made in just equivalent numbers to replace the ones that need to be replaced due to age each year, and to put in any new sections of the grid that are being installed. And this number is absolutely nominal compared to the millions of these things that are now hanging in the air. Well, one thing that a coronal mass ejection event is going to do is to short circuit all of those ceramic insulators and make them all completely corrupted, so they won't work again. The power won't flow down that grid circuit again until you replace all of those ceramic insulators. Well, frankly, the factories just simply don't exist to manufacture them. And this is one of the problems with the capitalist model, is it doesn't build in any degree of redundancy for security of the actual population. And so in corporations we trust just simply won't do. The English grid is a slightly different affair. Fortunately, it was one of the few things to come, good things to come out of socialism in the early post-war years. And the British National Grid, the the I can't even remember what the bloody what the name of the what the acronym is now, but it's been corporatized for so long. But fortunately, because it wasn't built on a capitalist model, because it was built on a socialist model and built as a investment by the country in its own industry, it's fortunately fairly harmonic, and it's also has it has a level of redundancy and energy security built into its fundamental structures as an initial premise. However, due to successive conservative governments and the ridiculous bloody global warming lobby, we've now seen the mass closure of and demolition of a number of coal-powered power stations up and down the country. And indeed, there was one in Kent recently that, instead of being just shut down, they did a massive multi-million pound conversion to convert it over to running on wood waste. And it worked beautifully. It ran successfully for about 5 years. And then at the end of the test period, they shut the damn thing down and bulldozed it. Why can't they just mothball these things? You know what I mean? Can it be that hard? I mean, these places are vast. You know what I mean? It really wouldn't take that much to pay a bit of site security to keep the thing safe and plug all its holes and make sure that the rats and the pigeons don't move in too deep. I mean, keep it painted. It's not hard, guys. And again, our underground storage facilities, the country used to be dotted about up and down the country, especially during the Scottish oil field sort of boom. The country was dotted about with refineries and storage centres, liquid underground storage centres, like the one on Canvey Island for Tony out in Essex. And we actually faced a situation, I think it was 4 years ago, we had that really hard winter hit, and during that winter, which went on unlike this winter, seemingly forever, we got to a point where at the in the tail end and still in the jaws of the deepest of that an English winter can get, pretty much, and we had 3 days of fuel reserves left in the country. There'd been all of our gas is piped live, effectively, from Norwegian and Swedish oil fields, gas fields, and it's not stored anywhere. Well, one of those pipelines went down in the height of the winter, so effectively our gas supply was halved. And because of the complete failure of successive governments to provide redundancy within that system, we were facing, I mean, had the weather not broken, we were 3 days away from the gas being turned off. And that's like 4 years ago. Well, nobody's telling you that, are they? So, you know, none of this is particularly pleasant. Let's whack on a tune and let's come back with a few bloody answers to this, because that's really, I mean, you guys know me. I'm Mr. Solutions. To some degree, we're a bit damned if we do, damned if we don't, but awareness is part of, I mean, in being informed about a pending threatening situation gives us the opportunity to become well armed. And I'll cover exactly what I mean by well armed in a bit. What we got? We've got 8 o'clock. Yeah, got it. You're going to have this. It's really long, but you need to hear this. Fella Cootie, water got no enemy. Water rights. The late, great Fella Cootie there with water. He got no enemy. Water rights in Africa. Okay, so let's move into solutions. Now, first of all, if you don't already know what a what is, you need to get educated. That's what the Omniversity is about. Go use it. That's what all this last year has been about, is raising people's educational abilities, because it's not about innate ability. It really is just about the amount of time you put in, the amount of time and effort you put in. And by way of preparation, as much as I love the preppers, I think they're great. I think they're, I mean, I love the sort of eco warriors. I think everybody that's trying to do their best to live off grid and the eco lifestyle, admirable. Doing my best to do the same myself. I'm sitting by my wood stove, chainsaws in the hall for any fallen timber I see. I do my best not to use the car. I do my best never to shop at mainstream supermarkets. I compost everything. All of our waste is essentially, we do our best to only buy food that either, I mean, you can't really help it with certain tins and packets, but we do our best to buy food as a product rather than as a byproduct. So we tend to buy, you know, I mean, fruit and vegetables as fruit and vegetables, rather than pre-packed fruit and vegetables, all that sort of thing. Yeah, it does actually make a big difference. And essentially, you've got, in order to be able to understand your energy footprint and how to become energy independent, is largely a matter of understanding what a watt is. I think we can probably sort of duck to some degree what a watt is, and we can jump to 100 watts, because that's probably the first meaningful what is a watt. And 100 watts is your bright light bulb of the old sort of incandescent flavour. If you've gone out at low energy, the light is horrible, but energy savings are enormous. The consequence of the insistence of the adoption of low energy light bulbs and of energy efficient domestic appliances has actually reduced the overall footprint, the overall energy footprint of the domestic market by some 10 to 25%, I think, in the last 10 years. So it's definitely a movement in the right direction, and it could be said to some degree that there is a pincer action here of technological advances making possible what was just simply inconceivable to the writers of the reports that gave such grim warnings for the future. But essentially, 100 watts is your light bulb, a kilowatt is 1,000 watts. Well, now you're talking about a 1-bar fire, enough to keep your tootsies warm, but no good for heating your house. If you want to heat a room, really, you're going to need a 3-kilowatt appliance. Your kettle is likely to be between 2 and 2.7 kilowatts. Your 13-amp main, the one plug in your wall, can sustain a load, I think, is 5 kilowatts. So that's on a single plug. Your house is full of them, and you could load most of them up to that sort of degree. The wires coming into your house are 100 amp. Do the maths. I'm blathered if I can work out what the wattage is of that now. It's probably something around the 25 kilowatts mark, I should imagine. Well, a 25 kilowatt generating station, let's say hydro, 25 kilowatt hour hydro station would be approximately 30 feet across, about 9 foot deep, and would need an entire river to feed it, a fairly substantial river to feed it. If that was a solar array, well, it's roughly, let me get this right, it's roughly 0.5 kilowatt these days, because the efficiencies have improved, roughly 0.5 kilowatt a meter. So you would need 2 square meters to gather a kilowatt of that. So you would need 50 square meters of solar panels to meet that same demand. Now, fortunately, each house doesn't consume a 25 kilowatt load. I mean, it's possible on the supply, but not advisable. Certainly, electric meter is going to spin round at a rather alarming rate if you do. The general average consumption of a British household is around 5 kilowatts an hour. which basically means day in, day out, all day, every day, with a few spikes here and there, the average house is burning 5 kilowatts every hour. Well, that's 10 square meters of solar panels for 24 hours, and you only get light for 12 hours a day maximum. So you're gonna have to double that. So you can start to see how the renewable argument, while it's inescapable, the consumption has got to be reduced markedly. And that really is, you know, I mean, we're the numbers. You know, I mean, they may have the guns, but we got the numbers. And we can reduce our fossil fuel footprint very easily with just some fairly straightforward measures. Just avoid plastic packaging. Plastic packaging uses an incredible amount of fossil fuel. Try not to use your car. Try not to go joyriding. You know what I mean? Try not to take those unnecessary trips. Try and plan your usage of the resources that you have to hand. I mean, it's worth sort of bearing in mind that every pound that you spend is another litre of fuel that's going to save your legs a 5 mile walk at some point in the future. On the subject of solar panels, anybody that has, I would suggest, anything more than about £2,000 in savings will actually reap financial benefits by taking those savings out of the bank and going and spending that £2,000 on the cheapest solar array they can possibly buy for that money. There's two ways that you can do this. You can have a solar array that is not grid time verted, which will mean that when you're using the power from it, you'll have to disconnect from the grid, and then you're simply the user of your own power. But currently there are green energy companies up and down the country that are clamoring for your custom as providers of renewable energy. So there are deals going at the moment that are incredibly preferential, that should you put out the extra expenditure and go for the grid time inverter, which will allow you to connect your solar system to your domestic electrical system and have it running in parallel to your current grid input. That effectively, if your solar array is large enough and your consumption is low enough, your electricity meter will be turning backwards and the electricity company will be paying you instead of you paying them, and quite preferential rates as well at the moment. I think the returns are significantly higher than they were a few years ago. And essentially it's currently looking like the repayment of, and keep in mind that this is at today's energy cost figures, which are likely to skyrocket in the very near future. So now is the time to strike, really, with this. Well, to a degree, if you're not going to go ahead right now with this, then it would be worth sort of putting a 3 month deadline and checking back and seeing what the technology is doing every 3 months, but give yourself an upper limit of maybe a year for going ahead with it. So it may be incredibly prudent to put off investing in a photo PV array, in a solar panel array, right this second, simply because there are some burgeoning technologies that are massive leaps in efficiency. And if the projected efficiency increases are borne out and are not hugely reflected in the costs, now bearing in mind solar has been doing much the same Moore's law type exponential curve in efficiency and reduction in cost, where it's been effectively doubling in efficiency every 18 months and halving in cost. Not quite true, but certainly the if not the doubling in efficiency, then certainly the doubling in the amount of wattage that you can buy for your money. And while the entire system has been reducing in overall cost, so we're now effectively a pound a watt. So your £2,000 will buy you 2 kilowatts. Well, that gives you roughly a quarter of your daily consumption if you don't reduce your footprint. So that's a fairly good way to kind of view that sort of investment. It doesn't mean that if you haven't got 2 grand that you can't invest in solar as a protection. I would suggest that for my sort of neo-feudalist needs of minimal living on the road, I could probably have got by on as little as maybe 200 or 400 watts of solar panel. I actually had nothing like that, but I had the wind generator, which used to provide a significant extra bit. But essentially, 200 watt panel out in the sun on a car battery for the sort of 12 hours of a daytime or 10 hours of daylight hours is going to pretty much light your house for the dark night. And you know what I mean? Thinking about candles again, I suppose we better go there. Hoarding, there's zero point to hoarding. There's absolutely no point to. I mean, everybody should have a reasonable, at least a sort of 3 day supply of all of their major provisions. So they should have sort of dried food and tins in their cupboard to last 3 to 5 days. I think that's prudent on any sort of family or anybody, any community member. You know what I mean? 'Cause it doesn't matter if you don't need it at the end of the day. If the shit hits the fan, the fact that you're there as a provision will certainly enamour you of that community and possibly place you in a position of respect and some sort of authority. And this is effectively when societal structures break down, leaders have to take the lead. And if we don't take the lead, they will. So you know, I mean, collective societal cohesion is absolutely essential in these matters. And making sure that people don't panic, you know what I mean? Just trying to make sure that everybody's needs are met. I mean, I suppose I might as well point out here, I've got an old Land Rover diesel engine that I had planned on fitting to my Land Rover before they changed all the bloody London emissions regulations to make my proposed diesel conversion, which would have been an if energy efficiency saving on that vehicle, that particular vehicle, which I might point out is 46 years old and has had no major component replaced on it in the last 46 years, making it about 7 times more efficient than any goddamn price ever has even taken into consideration its excessive consumption of petrol during its life. The energy costs of actually manufacturing a vehicle are about seven times the energy that it will use in its lifespan. So my old Landy, being as old as it is, has outlived many of its successors. But anyway, as a consequence of this bloody legislation change, I found myself essentially lumbered with a Land Rover diesel engine that I had no particular use for. And there has been plenty of times where the 200, 250 quid, whatever I spent on the damn thing, would have been a real useful thing to have had in my pocket rather than sitting in a lump of metal out in my shed. However, I know that that diesel engine is more or less convertible to be able to run on any fuel, and I know how to convert it. So should the shit come down, if I can find myself a 20 kVA alternator to be able to whack onto the back end of that, I can run that effectively even off of anything like a wood gasifier. I would be able to run it off of, and run it off of anything, even down to like sort of cardboard and sawdust and any sort of old hydrocarbon remnants. And consequently would be able to generate current levels of energy provision for about 4 or 5 of the local houses on either side of me. And this is essentially how we can protect ourselves, is by making ourselves so goddamn useful that our own communities seek to protect both themselves and us. I mean, arming to the teeth really is no answer. That just makes you, I mean, one of the armed brigands. So really, the sort of provision, the provision for for energy security needs to be built into every home in the land. So if you've got the resources to be able to go out and provide yourself with a wood stove, even if you've got no means of accessing fuel to put in it at the moment, just get it installed. I mean, they're decorative. They'll just sit there. You know what I mean? It's not gonna rust. It's not gonna rust away. It's cast iron. It will sit there for 100 years without ever, you know what I mean, needing any attention. And should you need it, trust me, on a cold winter's night when your central heating goes down, you can go out and raid the local shops of their bloody cardboard boxes and keep the frost from your toes. Funny enough, wood stoves actually run really well on cardboard boxes. Incredibly efficient energy conversion. Yeah, the tricky bit is the electricity provision, really, because electricity is this slippery stuff. It's not easy to store, and as a consequence, it kind of needs to be produced where it's going to be needed. And this is kind of where I'm going in my personal life, is not only am I attempting to sort of rewrite some of the hydrodynamic theory about hydropower, which I'm having quite a degree of success with. I'm hoping to go into a new enterprise doing that very thing. But my specific intention is to make sure that whatever manufacturing abilities I manage to get underway, that they be powered, that they be the first thing that's powered from whatever the device is that we're manufacturing. And then again, I'll be looking to export that nodally. So, rather than necessarily looking for domestic customers, it might be prudent to look for other companies looking to go into manufacturing the same components. And this is essentially, if we can build energy security into our manufacturing processes. And some of this is just simply a matter of not throwing away the goods at the end of the day. I've heard a fabulous story recently of a Brazil nut shelling company that was about to go bust. I think that was actually in this country. And a renewables expert guy got to hear about this and went and saw the management and took a quick look at their sort of energy consumption figures and their need for the sort of the heat for the drying the nuts and the machinery for cracking the nuts and all of that. And it turned out that they were getting they were basically having to pay for the removal of all of the sort of nut husks and, of course, for all the heat and that. And he just took one look at these Brazil nut husks, and of course, what are they full of? Brazil nut oil. And then stuff like coal. So he's converted their energy consumption over to these Brazil nut shells, and now the entire factory is run on the waste product that the factory produces. And if you extrapolate this out to every single, you know what I mean, if you think about every double glazing manufacturer in the country that's producing like hardwood window frames and stuff like this, the amount of hardwood wood waste that's going to be being produced there locally on site, being fed into a combined heat and power plant, is not only going to be able to heat that particular unit and all of its employees, but possibly export that energy to the neighbouring units and reduce their energy footprint. And so it's worth all of you, you know what I mean, just going into work tomorrow morning, if you work, you know what I mean, it within the corporate world, and just taking a little look around you at what's being thrown away and possibly even what it costs to throw that away, because rubbish ain't cheap now in the corporate world. You know what I mean? You have to pay for all of your rubbish removal, don't you? Excuse me. And just see what can't be done about converting the byproducts of the industry that you're part of, even if that's an office, into an energy resource for the company that you're in. Maybe put a little word in your boss's ear about it, even about the solar. You know what I mean? The argument for solar is absolutely there. If your company is profitable and has any sort of financial reserves, then it is absolutely prudent. I would actually suggest that it's perfectly within the capitalist model that every goddamn company up and down the land should be installing as many solar panels on their roofs as they can possibly bloody fit. If the repayment is within 5 years, that's as good as any investment that you're going to make within the corporate world. And those solar panels last for up to, well, the specifics on the current PVs the silicon-based blue photovoltaics, is that they have a guaranteed expected lifespan of 25 years, and in that 25 years they have to guarantee up to 80% of original efficiency. So essentially that means that, yeah, not only are your solar panels going to last at least 25 years, but in that 25 years they're only going to drop in 20% of their initial efficiency. And if you carry that curve on to its logical conclusion, that solar panel could still be working because it's a solid state device and has no moving parts. It could have a lifespan, a projected lifespan of 50, 75, 100 years. You know what I mean? Before the output proportion drops off so markedly that it no longer becomes an effective device. So, I mean, there's one. Wind, you got a bit more problem with in this country. Unless you can put your thing right up on the top of a mountain or out at sea or whatever, turbulence at low level really destroys the majority of wind-powered devices in this country, and all of the major designs that are designed to work in much lower speed airflows or consistent speed airflows often have real problems when it comes to sort of high speed performance out and run away, become uncontrollable and have to shut down basically as soon as the wind speed picks up, and of course that's where your maximum power is. So there are some sort of fairly fundamental problems to the harnessing of wind. There's some pretty novel designs coming about. The variable vane technology, vertical wind turbines that are coming out now that use effectively like a helicopter blade to modulate the airflow into the device, and they seem to be producing some fairly consistent torques. Some very interesting low head hydro systems coming online that appear to be able to run on fairly nominal flow water systems. And none of this is rocket science. It really ain't. The basics of electricity have been understood for nearly 200 years, and the electric motor and the dynamo are hardly novel devices that are ill understood. You know what I mean? You've got them all around you, if only you knew where they all were. And a lot of these things, you can also turn the majority of motors into a generator. So if you've got something that acts as a motor when you apply electricity, often if you mechanically turn it backwards, it will output electricity. There's a few exclusions to that rule, but in the majority of cases. So, in preparation, what do you do in preparation? Well, like I say, in preparation, you increase your energy independence by increasing the variety of energy sources that you can draw from. You see waste in a very different way, especially things like sort of old lawnmowers and old chainsaws and things like this that are completely useless at the moment can be converted into fairly efficient little power plants should you turn your mind to it. And a lot of these smaller devices are a lot easier to run on some fairly novel fuel supplies. One place that you might want to go and look, if you're so inclined, is into the Stirling engine and the Phillips engine, what are known as heat engines. What we call the steam age wasn't actually a steam age, it was the age of the heat engine. And most people have absolutely no idea that there even was such a thing as a heat engine. Well, a heat engine was basically like a little coal coal burner with a small aperture that you'd load with already lit coals from a fire, and it had a large piston with a reciprocating beam and a small piston, and these things would be basically designed for well pumps, for lift pumps. A bit like your little hippo pumps are now, you know, you like submergible electric pumps, that sort of thing. And essentially you couldn't lower a running steam engine down a well and get it to pump water up. And this gets into all sorts of problems with priming and things like this. So in order to prime the pump, you really want it down where the water's at. Well, you can't go lowering an active steam engine down into a well full of water unless you want a bloody boiler explosion on your hands. And on the subject of boiler explosions, you know what I mean, the number of people getting killed every year during the steam age of major boiler explosions. I mean, entire railway stations being wiped out, and all sorts of, you know, I mean, whole factories being levelled. So steam was considered to be an incredibly dangerous tool to work with, and any steam engine was legislated, it was mandated that it must always be tended by an engineer. So, you know what I mean, if you wanted to steam power your mansion, well, you would have to pay a steam technician to stand there, and you couldn't just pay your lowly paid servants to use it. Well, this is where the heat engine came in, because any idiot could use a heat engine. You just shovel a bit of coal in it, give the flywheel a little tickle with your finger, and off they'd chug, and they'd quite happily chug away and lift water out of the well for 4 to 6 hours on a single load of coal. Excuse me, incredibly easy to make, almost maintenance free, pretty much trouble free. And so, I mean, again, I think it would bode well for everybody to take a little look into Stirling engines and Phillips in the Phillips cycle and things like the Rankine cycle. The four-stroke cycle as well, we're surrounded by these, again, I mean, I was discussing a minute ago the size of a 20 kilowatt hydro system being, I mean, in the sort of 20 to 30 feet diameter by, I mean, several meters deep, certainly a number of tens of cubic meters of land and riverside resource being used up simply to produce 20 kilowatts. Well, out under the bonnet of your car on the drive is probably between a 75 and 100 kilowatt power source that runs on, I mean, we'll sit there and tick over quite happily for probably a couple of hours on a single litre of fuel. And this is what we got with fossil fuels. We have this incredible energy density that just simply isn't going to be available to us in any simple form should we waste this last of our material resources. And like I say, we have got a delta effect of the technological revolution, certainly producing an exponential rise in the efficiency of a lot of the equipment that we use. But the vast majority of the energy that we use as the domestic consumer isn't actually the stuff that comes in through our wall sockets and through our gas pipes and through our water mains. It comes in through the tyres on our car and the aluminium cans in our cupboard and the tin cans in our cupboard. And it's the refining and the manufacturing processes of those that actually provide our largest energy footprint. And so any amount of local sort of generation isn't going to really be a scratch on keeping those sort of services running. All of this really has to be factored in, and we have to be prepared for this. You know what I mean? If this is an eventuality that is either going to be meted upon us or meted upon our children. So it behooves us to prepare intellectually for its possibility, and not to be alarmist, but this economist that I was aware of in 2005 was essentially saying that the sawtooth that we're currently in of boom and bust economics due to the actual onset of peak oil would only have a 15 to 20 year lifespan. Well, that's 2008. So we're a good chunk into that 15 or 20 years already. So, time may be short, folks. Now, as far as the sort of personal preparations, one thing that we can kind of be pretty sure of is that refined steel products are going to be in great demand if we begin to see shortages and crises, especially, you know, even just a failure of the grid, like the gas supply running out. You know what I mean? You don't want to be sitting in your house watching your elderly neighbour dying of the cold because, you know what I mean, their gas supply has been cut off when you could kick their the bit of hardboard in that's blocked off over their old open fireplace and supply them with enough wood to be able to heat themselves, and supply yourself with enough wood to be able to heat yourself if you were prudent enough to have kept a bow saw blade and a bow saw greased up in your shed, and possibly a small splitting axe. these sort of things. You know what I mean? Don't worry too much about the large scale, because really it's going to be the thing between your ears that's going to be the best tool that you have. So if you're going to do anything, sharpen that bloody tool, and just ceaselessly sharpen it. Become a dervish of sharpening activity, because the quickening is upon us, and if we don't speed the bloody hell up, we're going to be left behind. Hurry or you'll be late. What do you mean late? What's your name, Earthling? Dent, Arthur Dent. Hurry, you'll be late, as in the late Dent, Arthur Dent. Sorry, Earth humour is lost on me. Sorry, I'll be back in a minute. Alright, last few minutes of my blather, so let's get heavy with the solutions. So what do we do? I've already given you all the investment solutions and all that crap, and you know, I mean, keeping engines and things like that, if you haven't actually thrown it away already. Wouldn't necessarily go out and get those things. And the solar panels, yeah. Mahatma covered in the chat, doesn't solar panels consume more energy in their creation than they'll create in their lifetime? Not quite in this day and age. A lot of the solar manufacturers in Japan certainly are attending hugely to their energy footprint of their products. So if you are concerned about that sort of thing, then yeah, of course you could pay a bit more for your panels and make sure that their energy footprint isn't adding to the problem rather than subtracting from it. But like I say, I think in this current situation, we're really looking at either protecting our own security or protecting the corporate and national security. And I think that national security starts at home. That's the long and the short of it. So national energy security is where it's at in the coming century. And national energy security depends on personal energy security. By way of what I would keep in the cupboard, I would keep in the cupboard a 3 to 5 day supply of dried food. I would keep a number of packets of sort of dried vegetable seeds. Would certainly do my best to keep a non-plastic set of garden tools. You try turning the bloody ground without a decent fork, or with a fork with a plastic handle, where the plastic has now degraded due to the ultraviolet and has become brittle. Again, where all tools are concerned, try and avoid buying modern tools with plastic handles for preparation. Modern plastic handles aren't produced for durability, they're produced for comfort, rarely last for more than 5 to 10 years. So you'll put them in your toolbox, you'll go to use them, and the handle will crumble in your hands, making the tool effectively useless. No tool is any use at all without something to sharpen it on. Carborundum will be at an absolute premium. It's almost impossible to keep a tool steel tool sharp without a carborundum stone. So an oil stone is definitely an absolute must, preferably a two-sided one with a coarse and fine side. Cost you a couple of quid in this day and age, could be worth an absolute life, and could be worth your life at some time in the future. They're quite brittle things, so worth keeping that one tucked away out of harm's way, but somewhere that you can find it. A decent set of chef's knives, I think, is something that everybody should have anyway. Axe heads. Axes are an absolute vital survival tool for all sorts of reasons. But primarily because if the, let's say that gas supply situation the other year ran to the 3 days of its conclusion and the gas supplies began being turned off, even if only intermittently, that having the means with which to be able to fell and split wood is utterly vital. And like I say, the bow saw, the greased bow saw with a sharp blade, trust me, you do not want to work with a blunt bow saw. Possibly even something that, again, you know, I mean, I'm very skilled with a bow saw. I can use a bow saw about half a dozen different ways. And can quite literally fell major trees with a 24-inch bow saw. Given the desire. There are two types of bow saw blade as well, and it's always worth having the both. It's always worth having the green wood and the hardwood saws, because trying to cut the one with the other is virtually impossible. I would go for the 24 inch plus bow saw blade, bow saw set. Again, these are going to cost you an absolute pittance in this day and age, but I am bow saws probably less than a tenner online. A good one, maybe a bit more than that. But like I say, you know, I mean, a decent bow saw, and you can, if necessary, fell significant trees. When it comes to emergency fuel provision using trees, it's worth mentioning here that some trees are burnable live, a lot aren't. Ash and beech are the ash and silver birch are the primary ones in England that you can cut essentially live, and essentially without doing a great deal of harm as well. A coppiced birch or ash will live for thousands of years, quite frequently delivering up its crown. Right, we're pretty much out of time. I'm not even going to be able to play this last one out. So, sharp, old-fashioned metal tools stuck away in the shed, slaver of grease, carborundum stone, a few days reserves in reserve. Go to the Open Omniversity, please. You know what I mean? Get educated, folks. Learn what consists of and how you can make one for yourself. Absolutely essential. Good night.